I did another survey. I thought it would be interesting before I made this video to find out what people know about Vase Mode. So I asked my subscribers what they think the thickest line width you can do on Vase Mode is, and I chose a 0.6mm nozzle size. I did this for a good reason, but we'll find out why in a moment, along with the results. Yes, I am going to make you watch to find out. Don't worry though, this is good. I feel like I'll be using the English pronunciation of vase in this video. I feel awkward saying vase, and I considered vase, but I think it sounds oddly posh, so I'll stick to vase, and I'm sure you'll all know what I'm talking about. So fundamentally, the problem with Vase Mode is that it's fragile. Arguably, it's a setting that's useful only for showing off how fast a printer can generate an object, and it has little other practical use. But if you've watched my videos before, you will of course know where this is going. That is, assuming that the title and thumbnail didn't tip you off. We are going to push this as far as we can. I'll show you the survey results first though. This is interesting to me because initially the 2x nozzle width was the one that was winning, but then the first two options have got some votes later on, so if I did leave the thing to run a bit longer, it could well end up skewing further towards the first two options. I'm sorry to say though that if you answered either of the first two options, then you are quite a bit short of the limit. Though I don't blame you, the idea of extruding a line a lot wider than the nozzle is unintuitive. Although I did mention in my last video about the relationship between nozzle and line width, i.e. there isn't one. But go watch that video after this one if you haven't yet. People seem to like it, even though I personally didn't like it, but that's how it goes sometimes. Where were we? These bins, trash cans, I wanted some really strong actual bins for the office, so I printed these out. Not only are they really useful and strong, but they took under 3 hours to print. Under 3 hours, and they're pretty much full print size for the area on the Ender 3. If you've ever done any full bed size prints in the past, which I think most of us have at least sliced them, looked at the literal days to print, and then noped out of it, well, to get something this big in 3 hours really is only possible in Vase Mode. But look how thick they are. It's really hard to show you how robust they are on camera, but these are night and day compared to normal Vase Mode. These can actually be used as bins without having to sort of treat them carefully. And these were printed at 1.2mm on a 0.6mm nozzle. So yes, the 28% of you who voted for the 2x the nozzle width are somewhat vindicated, but not quite. I didn't ask what gives the best output, I asked for what's the thickest. We need to go thicker. But before we do that, let's pause and look through the bottom of this bin. You certainly wouldn't want to be throwing half-empty cans of Coke in here. We seem to have an interesting phenomenon. Phenomenon. It doesn't make a lot of sense either. I get that we're forcing the slicer to extrude much thicker lines than it wants to, but I can't see why it leaves so much gap between them. I think it's probably either a bug or a case of what do you expect if you start putting crazy numbers in issue. I tried a few things to fix this, if you do indeed want to fix it. For these bins, I wasn't bothered at all. Even as a mesh, the base is strong enough to hold a couple of kilograms. I did test it. But I wanted to try and solve it anyway, and I found two options. There's probably more. In fact, there's a third later on, but we'll get to that. Option one is to put a raft underneath, as I did on this model here. The key is to choose, say, three layers, and to make sure the raft extra margin is zero. And if you mess about with the spacings, this is what I used here, you will get a much stronger output. Because you've set the air gap here to zero, you end up with a raft that's stuck to the bottom of the bin, so it won't peel off. It's a hack. But it works though, so whatever, don't care. Here's a small box with the raft method too. This is a 1.2mm line width on a 0.6 nozzle. You can't really tell that there's a raft here, so it works really well. Option 2 is playing by the rules a bit more, and we're changing the initial layer flow value to higher than 100%. You might have to go quite high, and if you're running a low line height, you might also have to change the initial layer height too, just to give the goo somewhere to go, otherwise it tries to embed itself into the bed, and it starts getting really hard to remove. Which takes me straight to the next problem I saw, and that's the bottom staying on the bed when you pull the model off. This is one reason to use glass beds, which solves this 100%, because the piece just kind of detaches itself automatically, as you'll know if you run a glass bed, but there's still a potential issue with the bottom coming off anyway after printing, as it can be a weak point. The joint between the walls and the infill can be too small. Again, there is a solution, and that's to raise the infill overlap percentage. I found 60% worked well when using 2x nozzle width or larger in my experiments. Prusaslicer handles things differently. This is a sentence I seem to be saying a lot lately, but yes, Prusaslicer's vase mode is not the same as Cura, it seems. For one, Prusaslicer gets very concerned when you start asking for thick lines. You have to keep confirming that yes, you know what you're doing, which honestly gets annoying. But if you notice as well, you can't change the top solid infill width. And you might think, who cares, I'm not printing a top layer anyway, but actually Prusaslicer thinks you are. In fact, Prusaslicer is. It seems to put it down at the base. Now, weird as that seems, I actually like this because it means you get a good solid layer on top of the oddly spaced layers that both slicers seem to do when you put a huge line width in. The upshot is that the print doesn't have a see-through base. I doubt that it's still going to be waterproof, but it looks nicer. And yes, you can do this in Cura too, actually, and it does work. So there's your option three I mentioned before, I guess, for sorting out the mesh issue. I'm not sure why it took me this long to think about that, but there you go. That's the creative process for you. That's probably the option I recommend. So let's go thicker. This box was printed on a standard 0.4 nozzle at an eye-watering 1.4mm line width. That's more than three times the width of the nozzle. The box is pretty strong. I'd be happy with this strength. Now, Cura seems to break totally if you go higher than 1.4mm line width, at least on a 0.4 nozzle. Look at this. I actually didn't follow my own advice, and I started printing this without checking the preview, and obviously that's why you should check the preview, but I can confirm that this is exactly what printed out. Obviously, I cancelled it when I saw what was going on, but here's the bits from that print. Luckily, Prusaslicer, though, doesn't suffer from such a bug. Here's a bigger one with the same parameters as before. Again, this is fairly strong. There is no way a standard vase mode print would be usable at this size and shape as a storage container. I've filled this with heavy items and it doesn't break or bend. But we're still not thick enough though, are we? How about this? Those of you who answered 1.75mm, well, who's laughing now? This is 1.8mm. This is actually a wider line width than the filament going into the nozzle. Think about that. This is still on a 0.6mm nozzle. Could you actually do this on a 0.4mm nozzle? Not sure. I wouldn't recommend it. The only thing I do recommend here on a 0.6 nozzle is slow down a lot. If you think about what's actually going on here, you're incurring a lot of pressure on the nozzle and a lot of filament will also be passing through. So the last thing you want to do is remove the thermal energy from the heat block and then you end up putting more pressure on the nozzle because it ends up clogging. If your extruder starts to click on prints like this, then it's a sign that you need to either raise the temperature to give you more tolerance to work with, or you can slow down. Interestingly, on these thicker prints, you start to see some weird artifacts. When you go above the 2x the nozzle diameter, you start to see these diagonal lines, and they get more obvious the more above 2x you go. I can't really work out what they are. I haven't come up with any decent explanation as to what would cause them, because they're diagonal, which makes no sense. If you have any ideas, then comment below. Unfortunately, our game comes to an abrupt end at 2mm thick. This box did print at 2mm wall thickness just fine on the 0.6mm nozzle, but as you can see, it looks horrible. Now, if you just wanted an ugly strong box, then you could still do this, but this looks like about as far as we can go. Interestingly, the next thing I tried to do was to swap to a 1mm wide nozzle and try the 2mm box again. Now that would be double the nozzle width, so it's not breaking any of our previous rules. And it does look better actually, but still not particularly acceptable from an aesthetic point of view. But we should certainly take a moment to appreciate that we can print at 2mm thick at all on these printers. This is around 12% wider than the incoming filament, which is mind-boggling. But anyway, let's summarise what we can realistically do to get good results without any of this ludicrous stuff. If you're also thinking there's no point going larger than 0.6mm on nozzle size, then I actually agree with you based on this experiment. This is definitely a conversation for another time, but yes, it does seem like nozzles larger than 0.6mm are quite redundant, at least on this kind of printer. That is interesting. So there you have it then, extreme vase mode. I think it's pretty extreme. Thank you for watching.